It's a couple of them.
I'm very independent. If anything happens to him tomorrow, I'm still able to take care of all my needs.
Yeah.
If anything happens to me, I know he's capable of taking care of all our three children. So I don't look at people and be like, everyone love his name. Madam, I need no food, yes. Baby.
Saibun. Hey. Go on, Daro. Go on, Daro, face. You don't say you.
Yeah, but I'm so happy and I'm so proud when you're doing good. Like, I get so proud. Like, he will tell you, I'm proud. Like, you're doing something good. I get proud. Like, the story that he just told, it makes me proud. Like, I look at him in a very different aspect.
Then
you want to cross it out, but then you were like, no, what? It hurt me to the core. I'm not gonna lie. But I was like, this is something that. Is this in my design for my house, Pantalo?
Chilu, Cliff, and Vincent. Today we are talking about what you guys should know before moving to the US. You know, this information might help someone out there, be it in Zambia, be it in Nigeria, Liberia, wherever you're from. So I'll be asking the questions and these guys have been living in the United States for a minute now, so they have enough experience. They have enough experience to. So, first things first, I'll start how you guys felt when you landed. What was the feeling like? What was going through your mind?
I'll go first. Because I came here when I was 16. 16 years old.
Actually, on top of that, let me add on. You came here when you were 16. That means you came here with your parents.
I did. I came here with my mom and my sister. Yeah.
So what was it like? Because in Zambia, parents are a little bit strict. And when you come out here, the life is different. What was it like?
It was very strict, and my dad was a very strict person. So me coming here, in my mind, I was like, okay, I don't have to work, because you know, I had that American aspect.
Yeah.
Where you don't have to work and you don't have to do this. So I came here when I was 16. And then when I came here, it was like a night and day.
Yeah.
Because I left, you know, my first love, you're leaving and then you're going to this whole country. You don't even know who you're going to meet. So it was kind of like, that's how it was a shock for me.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I came in the, like it was, I came here September 22nd. So it was like, we were kind of like, we were in the fall season.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was before the snow.
So how do you find it? Was it really cold for you?
It was, but again, it was so pretty. It was like, I'm like, I see the snow. I'm excited because, you know, back home, you only see the snow in movies.
Yeah.
And you're like, I need to see this, touch it, and it's cold, and you're just like excited. But at the same time, it's like you want to wear a t-shirt because you know, like it's snow, you don't know what you need to do.
Yeah.
And you're 16 at the time, so what do you do? But that's how I felt. I don't know how he felt when he got here because he was way older than I was.
Let's see what Cliff has to say here. What was going through your mind when you landed in the United States?
I think, because I'm getting old, so I don't remember.
And on top of that, how easy has it been for you to adapt?
So the first question first. I arrived here, I think I was 23.
Yeah.
So I had a little bit more perspective on certain things.
Yeah.
But the picture that I had when I was home and the real picture that I got when I arrived here, it was not the same.
Yeah.
Because when I was back home, you think everything that you see in the movies, you know, everything is green, you know, everything is nice. But when I arrived here, not everything was the way I thought it would be.
Okay.
Yeah.
If I let him continue, he'll answer literally every question. I'm like, okay, I'll move on to him.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. If I let him continue,
so
he'll answer.
Just to
he can summarize. You can summarize.
Just to put it in perspective. When I first came to the States, I went to California, Los Angeles. But in the Los Angeles that I thought back home was not what I found when I arrived home.
What did you find?
Reality.
What was reality to you?
Reality for me was, you know, you driving down the streets, they're not green, they're not Hollywood.
Yeah.
So, totally different picture from
what?
Yeah.
So, Mr. Vincent, what was going through your mind? Pemuna Fika, bah, you landed. United States, boom, you see the flag.
You know, man, I come from a very, you know, what can I say,
the
lowest community in Zambia, from Matero. And having been born in an environment like that, and raised from an environment like that, the United States was very overwhelming for me.
Yeah.
Extremely overwhelming.
Yeah.
As CJ said, as people said, you know what, when I got here, it took a while for reality to click in, actually, you know, for me to adapt.
Yeah.
Knowing, even as my sister said, that, you know what, I thought things were going to be rosy.
Yeah.
And then I realized that, you know, you gotta work for anything in this country. It's all about hard working.
Yeah.
If you want to be happy in the United States, you gotta work extremely hard. Mm-hmm. You gotta work for anything. There's no freelance here, as people think this is at home. You have to wait for what you get.
So, Mule.
Yeah, just it'll be something very similar to what Cliff and he said, because it's not really what you expect. You know, the image that we have back home in Zambia, you know, from the watching MTV movies, it's only the good side of America that they show, right? Mm-hmm. So that's the picture that we come here with. And we think, oh, it's all just this and that. But when we landed, me and you remember we landed 2015, I think that was May the 18th or the 20th, JFK, New York City.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when I got here, I was amazed. I was like, wow, this is beautiful. You know, like, I was looking forward to life in America.
Yeah.
But a few days later, reality starts to kick in. You have to start working right away.
Yeah.
There's nothing
and the other thing for you guys, you guys were not even given a break.
Exactly.
You guys arrived.
Came in. So it was like,
I think less than 72 hours.
Yeah, we were.
You were working for McDonald's.
Yep.
Yeah. There was no probation.
No.
We started acclimatized. You guys didn't have it.
Yeah, because if I can say it, I think that literally I've been working since the day I got here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Since everyone was talking about working. Mm-hmm. Is it really green up pastures? Is it, how easy is it to find a job?
Let me start with that. Economically and from a business standpoint, it definitely is green up pastures. If you have a plan, you're coming from Zambia, an economy that's, you know, lower than like the US economy.
Yeah.
And you have a plan, you want to start a business, you just want to get into some stuff that you need. Capital, right?
Yeah.
America is definitely a good opportunity to raise that money that you need. But it's also an opportunity for you to do things that will just take you off course.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's so much stuff to do here. You can have $1 million in America and blow it in the same day.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? There's so much stuff to do.
Yes.
But it's definitely greener pastures.
Because I got something to say about working here. It's like, okay, you come here and you...
Who's there?
I'm trying not to drink it because I know that you are watching. But anyway, you come here and you have this perception in life. And then it's like, okay, you have this, because in a, like, speaking, like, personally,
yeah,
I didn't become, I don't know, illegal.
Yeah.
Until I was like 19, and I was only that for like 6 months.
Yeah.
So you come here and, like, my dad was, he was a student when he came.
Yeah.
And he lived in London, then he came here. So I had everything that I needed until the day that he died.
Yeah.
So it was like, okay, man, you want color illegal. What are you supposed to do?
Yeah.
Like, it's like everything falls on you.
Yeah.
Me, I was like my mother's oldest child at the time. And then I looked, I was like, okay, what else can I do?
Yeah.
The only thing we all know.
So, I'll move to you, Mr. Benson. What was it like for you? Is it greener pastures for you, or is it easy for you to find a job in the United States? You know, would you lose a job today?
I would say most definitely.
It is easy.
Not just myself, but I've seen people who had, you know, kind of like good jobs at home, and they came here.
No, I mean, when you
arrived. When I arrived, well, I came through a program whereby when I just got here, I had a job on the spot. When I just got here, actually, I got paid when I was at home.
Yeah.
Before I came here, by the guys that brought me here. When I got here, I was already working. And then, you know, it was after my visa kind of like expired, then it got kind of like difficult.
Yeah.
But still kind of like managed, you know, to work around the system. But to tell you the truth, it wasn't easy even to get to know how to do stuff in the initial stages of my stay here.
Yeah.
You know, it was kind of like hard when I got here.
Was it greener pastures for you when you arrived? Was it easy for you to get a job they don't, you know, you lose a job tomorrow, you get a job.
For me, just like Vincent, you can't mind that simple. So, you arrive, you have a job. But after 90 days, you don't have a job. But it was not easy. But for me, I have friends that hook me up with, they say, oh, you know, come to Pittsburgh. You know, my first job, I said my first job, if without an ID, no anything. Everything was just based on trust. Like, oh, okay. Somebody vouches for you and says, oh, you know, Vincent is good.
He's good.
So great the job. So they give you the job.
Them
you start working on your paper.
Coming because they had social security numbers. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? I didn't. I've always had a Pennsylvania ID.
Yeah.
So even if they look me up, I've always had one. But with them having a social, that's what made a difference. That's what makes a difference for the whole bunch of people that have problems. Because you need to have a social security to actually have a job.
Yeah.
And that's why, like in our case, they trusted us. They have social security numbers, so they're good for something.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, that's what it is.
So who didn't go here? Okay. The next one is, what do you miss the most about Africa, Zambia, to be in particular?
I'll go first. You know what I miss about back home is the family environment. I miss family. I miss, I just miss the fact that I can go to, like, let's say I go to my auntie or my grandma's house and just be happy. We don't get that here. You go to somebody's house, they watch from what you're wearing, how much you're eating. Oh, like, it's not the same. I miss home for family, and that's the reason why I want to go back. I miss the family dynamics, and I'm a family person. When I see people, he will tell me, I get excited. I get excited when I see people, and people are like, I mean, I love family, I love people. Like, I'm a people person. So, like, when I don't get to, it's not even about the food for me. Because I can cook my own food, because I cook 24/7, you guys know.
Yeah.
But the fact that I can see my family, I can see my cousins, my nieces, my nephews, and I'm not, that's what I miss about back home. I don't know how everybody
else.
Back home, so many things. But yeah, but really, just like she said, the family aspect, you know, even just like neighborly and, you know, how we trust our friends, us for us. Kawata, like, you know, like throughout the day would be, let's go here, let's go see this guy, let's take a walk. You can go to your neighbor's house like that, you know, but out here it's like everybody's too busy working and just chasing their own individual agendas, whatever.
So about everybody,
nobody
else
really has time to come together. And just this life was simple back home, but we were still happy.
It was hard, but we were happy.
Yeah.
You would eat shit.
So you mean,
you mean
how compared to living in Zambia and living in the United States, which one would you say?
I will go back home any day.
Yeah.
The older I get, and people, you don't realize that. Like, I tell him, sometimes I'll be like, I would rather I'm eating shima under the moon. Could be my life.
Yeah.
But you love each other.
Yeah.
Like, you're like, there's nothing like that here.
Yeah. Alright. Just before, let me go. But I'll say this. I think it's something, you have to trade something for something, right?
Mm-hmm.
And at a certain point, I think for me personally, for me in Zambia, I think I reached the ceiling, like where from at that level I was, I really couldn't go any higher. Mm-hmm. So for me to like achieve other things, I had to move out
and sometimes,
out of that environment.
Yeah, because even coming to you, because people at work will ask me, do you really want to go back to Africa? I said, listen, I have achieved everything that I have to achieve.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, I can go back home and still practice my nursing career. Yeah. Mm. I will still be a nurse. It doesn't matter where I go. Mm. And that's the reason why I chose the career that I chose.
What do you miss the most about Zambia?
He doesn't miss Zambia.
But Zambia, like they say, in our language, we say kwan and kwan.
Kwan and kwan. Your home is
home.
Home
is the hardest.
Home is home.
Home is
so
home.
So for me, like they say, it takes a village to raise a child.
Yeah.
And I feel where I came from, back home, even when we were young, playing soccer in the streets, you knew like, oh, I'm dad, you know, you knew when, like you pause the game, like time out, I'm dad, I'm happy.
Yeah.
So you stop the game.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's a good point.
If I did something wrong, where I didn't find out, it was not my parents disciplined me.
Mm-hmm. It was the
guy from the next street. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, white guy, you know, hey, do this.
Yeah.
So I miss the social aspect of our culture, mm-hmm. where everybody was involved in every child.
Mm-hmm.
Like sometimes you'll see what, you know what, get you Although sometimes, like, you know, like the women, you know, them people say, ah, sambala musha, you know, like,
Or
sometimes you find that someone, you know, like you move your cash, like, hey.
But like,
I miss that community aspect of the family.
Yeah,
like,
because we raised everybody.
You don't really
child.
Have to be like blood.
Like,
blood.
No, yeah.
But everybody
was
family.
That's the thing.
Yeah. Everybody was family. It was like, okay. You make a team.
And then we were so loyal because unga kamba tipelewa make Maria bangulisa my ice blocks. But because mama get chirufi, I bangulisa my ice blocks, and you love mama get chirufi, the whole team ubanguli mama get chirufi and bangulisa and nagula my ice blocks. Like we were like we always uplifted each other.
Very true.
Olo pali vitumbua. Ah, make vutu, make vutiwe. Pania we di clean. Change change the tibule vitumbua.
If there would be something that I would love to have near me, it's my family, my friends. And as all the guys have said, the community, the way we were raised, that love for each other. You knew when the people come out, baku wana tuja kwao, walibi vakudia. A mother would call you, wazi watuja, watateva kwa walibi nchito
padi. And we didn't even ask. But now...
You know, baku itana, chapa iwe, muze na bwiradi nsima.
But now, they will clearly ask you, and something that I do not do, they will ask you, who even asks that? I was raised in a home where, like, when a visitor comes to your house, whether they ate or not, you have to cook for them.
That's something that I was saying in the house, like, I was saying exactly that. When I was asked way more, I said Cliff and Chibu's house. And the question was, you know, how is it? Why them? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
The same question that you asked me.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, jokingly, I said, you know one thing? When I go to her house, she'll cook. Mm-hmm. She'll cook because as Zambians, we don't want to let someone leave kunyumba or where you visit,
I don't even
and you
do.
Let them
That's
leave
the
like
thing.
That.
I don't even do.
Yeah, right, right.
They
right.
don't ask you, yeah. say, you know, did you eat?
Because my mom has implanted that seed in me. And like sometimes he knows, like I'll be upstairs, because Nima Sevens are my doubles, you know. I'll be upstairs in the bed, right? Laying down. And this is exactly how this man comes. He was like, hey. And he would hold me like this. I know you're tired. But can you do me a favor? I said, what? And I was like, what? Babe. When I'm downstairs, when the big one see me, I will throw my tantrum upstairs. But I will still come downstairs and I still cook. Because not only him, but I was raised by a good mom.
Right.
That will always like, ororero, napika chihuahua. He told me to cook rap. We didn't napika chihuahua. I said, you know what? I was thinking my sons. And you know, I know you're not that older than me, but in my mind, like you're my brothers.
Mm. Yeah.
Like I look at you, like when I look at you.
Like she cooked a special batch of chihuahua. Like yeah. I have to cook the chihuahua.
I said, I don't care.
What were we talking about the other day?
Exactly.
I was like, yes, Friday, and because whenever I'm done with my route deliveries. That's when he's studying, but so on the road we talk to each other like, boy, in it, I was pick and see off, and even if
not, and I stated, this day and that I should deliver, could do my
but I mean, every once in a while, but it's not the same.
I'm honest with you. I enjoy Shima when I come here.
Yeah.
And you see, I looked at my sister, I said, she manages to cook.
Yeah.
I said, I don't care. Example, pick and see. You know,
but
I like
you're forgetting Shima. What he's saying. It's not the fact that he cannot cook Shima, but when he comes here,
he eats the
and
Shima.
I cook the Shima.
That's what I'm saying.
It's different.
Mm-hmm.
We have to go.
But let me tell you, the one more thing that, like, back home, that I know each one of us knows it.
Mm-hmm.
Like we would have a funeral,
mm-hmm.
and the old women will get a basket,
yes, go around
and go around,
mm-hmm.
collecting mealy meal. Mm-hmm. It doesn't matter whether you roll a meal,
chomo meal.
But if we know that there's a funeral for number 47 or number 45,
they'll get the mealy meal.
The funeral house will make sure that they mealy meal and there's food. And people even go to the extent of making sure that the people that are mourning, at least you support them and just, you know, be there on their side.
Yeah. Let me just add up one thing. I'll give a very good example. And I've always said this, I mean, it's two families, the husband, you know. Before I came here, CJ used to live 5 minutes from where I used to stay. And you know what, because of the nature of being in Zambia, CJ knew the environment where I was staying at.
Yeah.
And you know, CJ had his own place, right?
Yeah.
And which is not down here in this country. He would always not see this guy here. He always likes to hang out with friends. And instead of going to where I was going because I was being kept, not by my parents.
Yeah.
Instead, he knew that Vincent is going to come to my place after I get myself, I enjoy with my friends. Of which I cannot do it in this country. To go to someone's house without an appointment and just go and knock on their door and say, Nabuela Funo, let me just eat.
Yeah.
I'm coming to eat. I used to go to his house and be like, that was the problem. I would say, man, I just want to chill here for a little bit before I go there, where I stay at.
Okay, let's ask the next question.
Mm. Before I even ask this question, I won't ask. This question is a little bit controversial.
Okay.
So I'll tell a story before I ask the question.
Before you ask the question, okay.
There was a story I read in the newspaper, Kuzambia. It was about a guy that used to live in Mkawata,
mm-hmm.
Mkawata Culture Village. He met this white girl, because it's an abogula something from him.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's an abogula something. Then, Bogula people, you know, they exchange by numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Then later on, I'm to meet them girls. I'm trying to, you know, summarize the story.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm to meet them girls saying, okay, it's ready. come pick it up. Mm-hmm. She picked it up, then, you know, she went, as usual, with my sister. Mm-hmm. Then she later came back to America, mm-hmm. She started going through certain, you know, situations, and she didn't have anyone to talk to.
So she called the guy. Okay.
So they ended up falling in love.
Is the game moving?
She called the guy, and the guy later came. And I'm not really sure exactly.